Part 2. Cox always showed a tendency to bury. Due there should be no more doubt about this. To the erratic use of one of the four divided sperm cells. To the erratic use of one of the four divided sperm cells, that is to say, any of the four resulting mature sperm unities may be used in fertilizing an ovum, so that the full brothers may be absolutely different in their qualities. Patience and persistency in selecting a desirable breeding type in your stock will lead you to desirable results after all. Though there are all probabilities that if you reach your standard for hens in 4 generations or 5, it will take you about 4 times as much time to reach the same standard of perfection with your male line. Of course, you may be one of those lucky breeders that hit the nail with the first blow, but let nothing lead you believe that luck will cling to your breeding operation just that easy. In the long run, only the deserving have luck, and believe us that long experience and serious investigation and observation of irrefutable facts lead us to advise you that no honorable breeder should let luck take any part in his breeding operation. Chance plays an unavoidable part anyhow, as nobody can state definitely when his breeding stock came from, but as soon as you have tolerably selected and pure breeding stock, stick to it. For all they are worth, if they are not as good as the high standard desired for the pit, which is a serious matter despite what all detractors say, better scrap your stock and get reliable breeding stock elsewhere. Whatever the price of good stock is, as soon as they reach the high notch of sufficiency, they are valuable animals produced with greatest luck or care. And we quite agree that many specimens, especially breeding hens, cannot be paid decently even if counterbalanced with money. One must wonder how some breeders can depend upon pitcock breeding as a business, facing the competition of hundreds, like him, who fight for lower prices and rates. And we believe that the newer time in which everything appears to have a market price is responsible for such an unsatisfactory state of affairs. Nobody but the breeder known exactly what his cocks are worth. And by a breeder, we mean a man that has stuck to his strain in all its purity and has not been led to cross for obtaining higher quality. Of course, crossing may be resorted to earlier or later for some convenience, such as originating new strains of imparting vigor to a weakening strain. But those who have neither that experience nor sufficient knowledge should keep their hands off. We have seen what selection means based on the techniques of cell division, and which impact comes to the bottom of the correct of success, bottom of the secret of success, which in the shortest way spells inbreeding. There is a difference between disorderly inbreeding of nearly related stock and a scientific inbreeding of improved lines. If carried on properly, there should be no deterioration in the offspring by inbreeding. But as in every phase of natural laws, order is the prime condition. We have evidences accumulated in cock breeding and breeding different domestic animals that the highest prepotency or power to transmit individual qualities is attained only by constant and judicious in breeding. Such is the case with racing pigeons, pit dogs, horses, cattle, sheep, and swine. Furthermore, there are evidence that wild animal species which show a remarkable uniformity are the more uniform, the more inbred they have been. Where a breeding is resorted to occasionally naturally variation sets in, producing varieties and sub-varieties that are the direct effect of crossbreeding. When fowls are bred in, it can be done in two forms. In vertical sense, from parents to offspring and grandparents to grandchildren, or in horizontal sense, from sister to brother or intercousins. Some recognize also a diagonal line from uncles to nieces, but on observing carefully, in inbred stock, it always means a combination of both. The offspring always carries one half the blood of the sire and dam, and when either is bred of the offspring, there is always that one half of the other parent to counterbalance that effect of too intensive inbreeding. When the blood is two mates is alike or nearly alike, it terminates that the chromosomes in the germ cell cannot come to order, which finally means sex determination unsettled. The result is total, very seldom, or partial hermaphroditism. In such specimen, though sometimes the external characteristics show us either male or female sex, the glandular system is unsettled and incomplete. Consequently, the gland secretion is insufficient and general weakness of or scant growth is the result. Nature goes a step further in trying to eradicate constitutionally inefficient specimens, punishes the abnormality with reversion to mediocrity, giving place to a series of malformation that should play havoc with the stock in a short time. Loss of color in one of these tokens and in game fowl. Cocks that are too finely bred that will stand in any amount of cutting without fighting back, incomplete sex or partial hermaphroditism is the result of disorderly or horizontal inbreeding. It is almost as bad as crossing out and should be studiously avoided wherever possible. There are many theories pro and contra inbreeding, which all we have observed carefully. It appears that in some animal species, nature provided for means toward avoiding inbreeding, but we have a notion that when this happens, the corresponding species has reached a higher degree of organic development. And nature finds it necessary to cause variation by outbreeding. Our knowledge of wildlife, however, is so restricted that we cannot judge every piece of it, but we may assume pretty sure that whenever a species is evolving towards a high standard of uniformity, inbreeding in a vertical direction is resorted to, but as soon as the standard is reached, nature provides for outbreeding. Okay, part 3.